हेलो एवरीवन एंड वंस अगेन वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल सर्वर ज्ञान। माय नेम इज डॉक्टर लोकेंद्र सिंह एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट लाइनेक्स इंटरव्यू क्वेश्चंस एंड आंसर्स। सो दीज आर द क्वेश्चन विच आर यूजुअली आस्क्ड ड्यूरिंग इंटरव्यू इफ यू से दैट यू आर एक्सपीरियंस्ड पर्सन। सो फॉर श्योर दैट चांसेस आर देयर दैट दीज क्वेश्चन डेफिनेटली विल बी देयर। ओके सो वेरी फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज हाउ विल यू चेंज डिफॉल्ट यूजर आई डी वैल्यू इन लिनक्स। सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल इफ आई एड अ यूजर एड मे बी Lokendra, if I run this command and I run a command id and then I mention Lokendra, then you will get to know the default user id is coming 1001, group id is coming 1001. So I want to make it 10,000. I want that if I create next user, so without passing any additional argument, that should be starting from 10,000. So there is a file in Linux, let me make it a bit large for you guys, /etc login .defs is the particular file. Okay, let us open with vi. So in this particular file you will get to know about each and everything, like you can modify that what is going to be mail directory, whether minimum password age, maximum password age, password warning, so these are the sort of things, like user id minimum. So this is 1000. So if I make it 10,000 and this I make as maybe 60,000 or maybe 6 lakh, whatever, so this will be changed by default. Fine. So what I'm going to do here is, like, if I add new user add maybe Tom, and after that I run command id, and after that I run this particular I give the username Tom. So by default user id is this much, and group id is this. So maximum user id it has given to me, but by default the user id which was starting from 1000, so that has been changed now. So it means that is up to us, that how do we need to modify it. Fine. So based on the parameters, based on the requirement, we can modify these values within this particular file. So as you see that I have modified this value, so you can modify it as per your own requirement. So user ID minimum will be 10,000, maximum will be this particular one. Fine. So what would happen here is, so you can modify it and you can do it whatever you like. Fine. So user at tom, if I run the same command once again, user at tom, maybe tom1, and if I run the command id and then tom1, so we can get to know that the user id is now 10,000. So based on the particular requirement, based on the particular configuration which we do there, so based on that, so it gets changed. Fine. So this is the answer of this question. How will you change default user ID value in Linux? So this is a particular file which is known as etc login.defs. Fine. Okay, so there is a particular term like root. It means we are logged in with root user. We are trying to remove a file we are going to run a command rm-rf temp test. It gives operation not permitted. So what could be the reason? So reason here is, for example, if I create a file here touch and /temp and test. If I run command rm-rf and then I specify the file name, so it is deleted. There is no problem. But if I run a command chattr plus I, and after that if I specify file name, once again if I go for removing this file, then it will give operation not permitted. It means if chattr is implemented on the file, then it will not be deleted, even if I'm trying to execute the command by root user. How will I need to change it? So I'll run the command chattr-i, and now the file can be deleted. So this is how it works. So you should be knowing about chattr as well. Okay, etc hosts. There is a file in operating system. So which RPM is responsible for creating this file? So if I run a command ll here /etc and then /etc and then host is the file name. So which RPM is responsible for it? Etc host is the file name. So which RPM is responsible for this file? So the command is rpm-qf and after that the file name. So whatever RPM is responsible for it, so we can get to know using this particular command rpm-qf and etc host. There is one more file resolve.conf. So over here, like file etc resolve.conf is not owned by any package. For example, the same thing, if I run the same command for temp/temp and test, okay, that's not the file, touch and yes, we can now check this file. So So like time test is not owned by any RPM. So all the files which are owned by some or the other RPMs, we can track that using rpm-qf command. Okay, so what is the difference between RPM and yum? So RPM means Red Hat Package Manager and yum means Yellowdog Update Modifier. Both the commands are used to manage software in Linux operating system, and especially these are used in Red Hat CentOS type of operating system. Fine. Where the extension of files are .rpm. Now, what is the difference? So if I run a command yum install httpd, so by default it will install with all the dependencies. But if I run command like rpm dash ivh, I for install, v for vervos and h for hashes, then after I specify the particular RPM name, httpd dash the version number, CentOS and whatever it is. So if I specify the the RPM name, then it will install. But what if I need to know like what are going to be dependency of this RPM? So there is one other question, that how will you check dependency? So the command is qpr. So this is the let me small q, capital P and capital R. This is the particular command which will let you know like what are the dependencies of it. So once you run this command, so it will print all the dependencies, like what are the files which are required for this particular RPM. If you want to install, so you will have to install these particular dependencies as well. Okay, let me try to install this rpm-ivh and then the file name if I give. So it will not be installed, error dependencies field etc mime.type. So as the particular thing which you were looking here, like etc mime.type, then after system logos. So these are the particular things which are dependencies of this RPM package. Moreover, like httpd tools, it is written here, same thing was written here, httpd tools, what version it is required. So this is the particular command which is used to identify that which dependencies are there of any specific RPM. So command is rpm-qpr. Capital P, capital R, and after that the RPM, like RPM. Okay, so I'm not going to install it, but I just wanted to show you that how does it work. Then after, what is difference between hard link and soft link? Okay, so there is a particular file, let's say ll/temp and the test. Fine. First of all, So if I create multiple ll-i for inode, it will print the inode number. So this is inode number of the file. So this is if I create hard link. So the command to create hard link is ln. I will specify temp, then test, then after /etc, and maybe Lokendra name I want to give it. So if I check the file ll-li, then after file name. So if you see, both the files have same inode. etc Lokendra and this particular has the same inode. So whenever I will create hard link, ln command is used to create hard link. So whenever and how many hard link I'm going to create, so the inode value will remain same. This is not going to get changed. Fine. So for example, if I create another hard link, maybe /mnt/Lokendra, I want to specify /mnt/Lokendra. So if I try to check the inode of this file, so for sure it is going to remain same. Moreover, if you see that earlier it was 1, the link was 1, after that it became 2 and now it is 3. So if I make one, if I create one more file -new, if I give a new name and if I try to run once again the same command and I try to check the ID of this, so first of all this number is increasing, moreover this inode number is same. So only like names are like getting changed. If I remove main file, then data is going to remain same, because until and unless there is a single name pointing to inode, my data will not be lost. Fine. So this is how it works. Then after, if we talk about soft link, so if I run a command ln link -s in soft link temp and after that test, and I want to make a link inside /etc, okay, let's make it in under /mnt/mnt and test. Fine. So if I run ll-li command and after that I specify the file name, so first of all the inode number is changed and this is showing only 1, and after that it is showing MNT test, and this is pointing to this particular file. Now if I remove this file, then link will get broken. RM, and if I specify the file name, yes, I want to remove it, slash MNT and MNT and test. Fine. So this is broken link now. Which means if you remove any single hard link, so main file and the data does not get impacted. But if you remove main file and the soft link will go abandoned, soft link will not work in that case. So these are the main difference. Moreover, hard link are supposed to be created on the same disk. For example, like if we have a mount point which is slash, and there is a particular another mount point which is slash data, and the disks are different, so obviously hard link will not span across the file system. Hard links are supposed to be created on the same file system, because inode is going to remain same. But in case of soft link, we can obviously create hard link across the file system because it has separate inode. Okay, what is stkbit? So stkbit is used if you run a command ll and you give a slash, then you will get to know there is one t written here. So stkbit is used to prevent unwanted deletion. For example, the owner of file or the root, only these two users can delete a file wherever stkbit is implemented. And moreover, you need to understand this, that stkbits are implemented on the top of folders, or you can say directory only, not on specific files. So as you see, that slash temp is a directory and stkbit is implemented here. So user Tom cannot delete files which are created by user Lokendra. So that's the particular difference here. You can try it yourself, and if you have any problem, so you can let me know, I will try to explain it. Okay, how will you check open ports on Linux server? So the command is netstat-tunlp. So this is the command to check what ports are open on the server. Then after, how will you check ports on a remote server? It means how will you check open ports on a remote server? So the command is nmap, the command is not available, yum install nmap -y. I will install this command, and after that I shall be able to figure out that what ports are opened on a remote server. Okay, so nmap -A, and after that the particular server, whatever you want. Maybe this is a DNS of Google. So I'm going to check the particular open ports on this server. So it can take some time, maybe 2 to 3 minutes, or sometime it is, if it is local also, within 10 to 15 seconds it gives result. But as this is of Google, so obviously it can take some time. Okay, so your site is down and throwing 500 error, how will you start troubleshooting? So as you know, it is showing 500 error. So there are multiple error codes like 00101xx. Then after, it could be your 2xx, 3xx, 4xx and 5xx. So first of all, you need to identify that what are going to be use cases of these particular error codes. Like why do we have 500, why do we have 400, why do we have 3xx, and these are these type of error codes. Based on the error codes, you need to identify that what particular component is not working. Like in case of 500, it means your database is not responding. So what server will you check first of all? Web server. So obviously web server is returning the result. Whatever result it is getting from backend, it is returning. It means web service is responding fine. So now how will you start troubleshooting? So that will be depending on the particular type of error code which you are seeing on the type of website. If you say that site is not reachable, it means web server is not responding. You need to check web server, your firewall, security group and other things you will need to check. So this is how you start troubleshooting. If you have really further questions on troubleshooting, that how will you start troubleshooting, so I will create a separate video on troubleshooting only, not a problem with that. Okay, so how will you start troubleshooting if your site is down? Same thing we have discussed. So then after, how will you create disk space if it is showing 100% used? So you will go here on this server. Okay, now we can check that the port which are opened over here. Nmap done, one IP address, host is up, these many seconds it has taken. So what type of ports are opened, so you can check out here. Okay, so let us go here, we have started the command here. So like one host is up, not shown these many ports, 453 is up, TCP wrapped, port 443 is up, is opened, SSL and HTTPS. Then after other things you can easily track what is operating system, what is like HTTP title and rest of things you can check here, fine. And after that you can check the traceroute as well, that how many IP addresses are there, like this is showing dns.google. So all the things you can check out here based on this particular command, which is nmap. Okay. So as you come here on the server and you try to run a command df-th, so you can check that what type of like uses are there. So the particular server is quite new. So it has only 1.2 GB used and 8.9 GB unused. Fine. So if I run a command here, like if I go to slash and I run du-sh and after that I space place asterisk, so I will get to know that what directories are using how much data. So based on this particular utilization, I will start checking that how much data can I release and what are the things I can perform here. Fine. So this is it, how I will identify and remove unwanted data. And if all the data is genuine, so there is only one way, that definitely I will have to increase the disk space. Okay, so what is the package of sar command and what does it do? So if I run a command sar, so sar command is not found, so package it yum install sysstat. So sysstat is a particular package name, you will install it, and after installing it you will enable it, sys, there is double s, so that's why it did not work, that's my bad, typing mistake. Okay, so sysstat is a package. Now it's not only the thing I'll have to do, slash etc default okay, so depending on the operating system, cron dot daily, then after sysstat cron dot d, I'll have to check that where is a particular file, cron dot d, this is early only, so let me check that what are the files of that particular. So I will do only one thing, I will pick up this rpm. So if I do not know like where, what are the files which are created by this file, so I can do this rpm-ql and after that the particular this one, like file system I can specify. So I need to enable this particular like etc sysconfig sysset. So this is the particular file which I need to enable. So what I'll do here is vim and after that, okay, vi and after that the particular file name I'll give. So over here I can check that what are the particular history and other things, reports. So what are the parameters do I need to enable, what is the particular directory it is going to give me. So these are the things which I can like modify and I can start checking it. Then after like if I need to enable it, so there is a particular file of it where I need to enable. So etc profile.d, no, it will not work. So let me start the service, slash etc init.d and sysstat, or maybe I can restart the service directly, service sysstat restart. Okay, so it is restarted, sar-q. If I run, then obviously I shall be able to figure out the particular load average and rest of things on which are running on the server. Fine. So this is it for this video, guys. Thank you so very much for watching. Have a good time and happy learning. If you have any further questions related to Linux or maybe other interview questions, so please do let me know. I will be there to assist you on that. Thank you so very much. Have a good time and happy learning. Stay home and be safe. Thank you.